стандартна частина. У нас є спонсори. Дуже дякуємо Aegis, які постійно нас спонсорують. Це дуже круто. Vice Engineering. Без них би цей івент не відбувся, але або відбувся би дуже по-іншому, тому їм також дуже велика дяка. І JetRuby. Це теж дуже круто, що вони нам допомагають і підтримують. Це маленьке, але дуже подорожуюче товариство. І у нас є доволі багато медіапартнерів. PivoDates, Pivorack, Котани, ArmyPod, Тернопіль IT Cluster та LambdaDays. Ну і, звичайно, HypeCode. Я думаю, що ви хоч когось не знаєте, раз сюди прийшли. Ну і як завжди, в нас вже така традиція, що в нас є форми зворотнього зв'язку, ви їх заповнюєте, і комусь пощастить, він отримає сувеніри. Тому що ми хочемо знати, про що розповідати, що зробити краще, що зробити по-іншому, і це для нас дуже важливо. І в нас є програмний комітет з дуже великої кількості файних людей, які допомагають спікерам та зазвичай самі являються спікерами. Але зараз з них є аж я та Юра, інші ще їдуть або десь знаходяться. І якщо ви знімаєте цих людей, можете їм задавати каверзні питання. Вони, як мінімум, щось знають про еліксір. Це точно, це без варіантів. Ми перевіряли. І сьогодні в нас доволі простий план. Спочатку буде розповідь про джин-сервер від Юри Бодарєва, потім про веб-перформанс від Стефана Вінтермайера, я це сказав з першого разу навіть, а потім Віктор Дерягін і GraphQL API на Еліксірі. А потім я розповім про розумні будівлю та IoT, в тому числі і про NERVS, якщо комусь було цікаво, що воно таке. І під завершення буде Євген Пірогов про ElixirConf.eu. Також є можливість розповісти щось, просто взяти і розповісти на Lightning Talk. Так що, якщо у вас є ідея, що розповісти за 3, 5, 10 хвилин, welcome, ми тут десь розмістимо дошку, на якій можна буде записатися. Хто хоче бути спікером? Ну, 5 людей, так, а хто ще? Так я і показую приклад, он мій приклад. Добре.
У вас є цілий день, щоб налаштуватися, та може
і підготуватися. Тобто, якраз презентацію на 10 слайдів можна зробити хвилин за 20. Так що, ви все можете. І давайте почнемо. Юрій Бодарєв. Розповідай.
Долго готовил вступительную речь, про то, как мне тяжело первый раз читать доклад на английском.
А это тебе дуже пощастило.
Да, если я буду звать слова по-русски, вы тоже не обессудьте. Итак, я расскажу про гель-сервер и покажу, в конце концов, пример того, как это используется в реальном проекте. Это будет часть проекта eHealth, над которым мы работаем как компания. Вот. Поэтому начнем с теоретического вступления и дальше увидим, где на практике, как это все выглядит и работает. Кто вообще хорошо знаком с эликсир-процессами, с тем, как они обмениваются сообщениями, насколько детально надо рассказывать вступление. Ну, короче, ясно.
Сейчас.
introduction first. Okay, everything in Elixir is about processes. You can easily spawn a new process. You need just class and function that will do some very, very heavy load job. And this job will, this process will work concurrently besides the caller process. This spawn function will return your, will return to the caller the process ID. You can use this process ID to interact with the process you just spawned. There is a mechanics to exchange messages between processes. Like if you have a process that do some heavy load, you need a way to pass the result back. So you can pass in this process the ID of the caller, and then you can use a special function. It's called send. This function accepts two parameters: its caller ID and the message that you want to pass to the another process by this ID. And in the caller process, you can use special receipt function and pattern match on this message. It's pretty easy. Okay, but if your process will take some time to do this job, then this function receive will block the caller thread, the caller process, until the message arrives. And if your process will, sorry. And if your process will take some significant time or will never return message that we are waiting for, or will just die raising some kind of error, we will wait for this message forever. In the caller process, we will wait for this message forever, and you have another option to kill your caller process because this function will never match anything. To mitigate this, you have a special after clause. This after clause allows you to pass a timeout and the result that you want to receive if the message never arrives. Like we have a 5 seconds timeout, and if this receive function will never receive the message we're waiting for in the 5 seconds, this process will break and we will just return this response. Okay, when we pass the message into the process, this message just forms a queue inside the process, and messages from this queue process in first in, first out order. Like we are sending to the process a bunch of messages, and we can call special functions that will show the message box of the process, and we can see that this process, this messages forms a queue inside our process. Messages from this queue will be processed in first in, first out order. Like we have this queue, we want to receive this another message. We are pattern matching on this another message atom, and after this two receive closes, we can see that we are extracted this and processed these two messages from the queue. If we will try to receive another message, like message with this atom, we'll pick up not the third message but the first, like the queue. We will process it from the beginning of each time. So if we have a message queue and we try to extract some message with receive, this receive clause start to pattern match on the process on the messages from the beginning of the queue every time. Like if some messages was processed, another messages will pick it up from the beginning of the queue. Okay, how we can use processes? The easiest way is to launch concurrent tasks. For this, Elixir provides us an abstraction, it's called task. It hides from you all this need for to make sense and pick up responses. You just telling, you just starting this task, passing in the function that will need to do some work, and you receive this special object. You can evade on this object and extract the results. So all this send and receive messages cycles are hidden besides this task. You can easily start multiple concurrent processes. Like here we're starting 10 jobs that will take some time to finish, then we wait, and then we get all answers at once because every this process that takes 3 seconds to proceed will work concurrently. So we will have all answers at once. The await function have a special parameter. It's hidden because it have a default value of 5 seconds. It's a timeout. Like task can await for the response if, for about 5 seconds, or you can change this value. But If the response didn't come in this given timeout, the task will raise an exit signal, and it will kill your process. So you won't receive any like kind of an atom, like error timeout, your process will die. So you need to take this into account, so you need to adjust this time, or you need to adjust your logic according to this fact that your task can die if it will not receive a response in a timely manner. Okay, another usage for the processes is storing some kind of state. It can be made by a simple trick. You can define a recursive function. Inside this function, you have receive close. This receive will wait for some kind of messages. These messages can adjust state and then send some answer to the call process. And this recursive function will be called again with a new adjusted state. So this function will store the state forever, and you can adjust the state or receive the state by sending some kind of a message. Here is an example, we are defining recursive functions. This function accepts some kind of a starting state, then it can adjust state, just add the value that we send in the message, send back a response to the caller, and start again with this new adjusted value. So we are starting this function with a zero value, we are sending a few messages. These messages will adjust the state by the two. And then we can check the message box of the caller process, like the internal state was adjusted every time and sent back to us. Elixir already provides another abstraction for this, it's called agent. This abstraction also hides all this need to define a recursive function, all this need to define receive send clauses from you. It just provides a set of simple functions. You can start this agent and provide some starting state, and then you can update this state, get this state or manipulate it in any way you need. Just passing the function that will make some manipulation with the state and return the new state back or send the response back to the caller. Also, all these functions that accept the response from the agent, they also have this timeout parameter, and if the answer won't come in the defined time, like 5 seconds by default, they will kill your process again. Okay, now we came to the gene server. Gene server is a kind of standard behavior. It allows you to define server-client relations in a some standard way, but it's more general than task or agent alone. So if you need to adjust it for some kind of special logic, like not simply storing the state or not simply like doing some job and receiving answers, the gene server is your tool. And bin server just start another process which have this receive and send messages inside, but this will hit it from you, and you just need to define some set of standard functions. So this is an example. I just took it from the documentation of bin server. This is a simple example that defines a simple stack. It just stores the states. But the idea is that code that you need to define, you will define this code in one module, but execution of this code will be divided into two parts. Like this part will work in separate process in your gene server. This part will be available to this part will work on your server side in your separate process. And this part will be available for client to start your process and to process some messages. Like you will call this function push and provide the idea of the GAN server process, but under cover it will just pass the message to the GAN server. The GAN server will receive this message in his message queue and start processing it. So it will look like this. This executes on the client side, this executes on the server side in separate process. Despite the fact that you will define all this code together. Okay, how it will work if you have this timeout situation, like your GAN server call, which you will call under the hood on the client side, it also have this timeout parameter, which is set to the 5 seconds by default. And if this timeout parameter will exceed this time limit, it will also produce an exit signal and kill your client. But the GAN server will still continue to work. So if you send some messages to GAN server and never got your response back, then your client will die, but GAN server will still have this message in his message queue and will still try to work out it and send an answer response back if it will be able to process it. So we will show this by simple example. We have this Win server call that will take a very large amount of time to work, like 30 seconds. And we are calling it from the client side, like we are starting our Win server, we are putting in the start, like just five simple numbers, and we're trying to get them back. We're just trying to get this stack pop. But this stack pop will call, will result in Win server call under the hood. This Win server call have a 5 seconds timeout. But in reality, on the server side, this function will take 30 seconds, so we will never receive the answer back. We will try to make this call five times, and every time we're receiving exit signal, because I'm doing this from the X terminal, it will never die, but the real process will die if this call timeout. But if we will check with this function per second call processing call, if we will check the message queue of the GAN server, we will see that even we have five dead processes, GAN server still have three messages in this message queue and try to process it. Like he will die on this one, he will die on this one, but every of these stack pop calls will reach GAN server and will still reside in the GAN server message queue until it will process. It will spend 30 seconds processing each of these messages, and until it process one of them and send the response back, it won't start processing another, despite the fact that caller process already dead and will never receive and process this response. So if we will wait for some long time, we will see that this message queue of the GAN server shrinks, and then if we will flash the message box of our caller process, we will see that we actually got all these four responses back, despite the fact that there is no way to process these responses because all our caller processes will never receive answer and already receive signals. So we will soon see how this will work in the real project, and now we will come to the real project. It's a microservice, it's a part of the Ukrainian e-health infrastructure. It's microservice called Digital Signature, and the responsibility of this microservice is to process all documents that come into the e-health system. Every document that come in the e-health system must be signed by the digital signature. Signature of clinic, of doctor. Then used to verify that every request that comes to the health system is authorized by the responsible person. So this digital signature will receive special envelopes, all JSON documents that are signed by digital signature. According to Ukrainian legislation, all digital signatures are processed according to the special standards, so you can use any like open source tools like OpenSSL. You need to use proprietary libraries, and we use one of these libraries in our project. This library is written in C, so it uses mechanics called NIF to interact with Elixir. It's a special set of libraries, a special set of functions that allow you to transform the parameters that come from Erlang to the parameters that can be processed and accepted in the C, and then make like transformation back. But the main part of this is that we can choose the tool that we will use to work with the digital signatures. We have a library that was provided to us, and we are sticking with it. So even if it has some problems, we can change it. Okay, this is a very simple diagram of how the digital signature works. Like, this is our microservice. It has a database of certificates that used to validate the digital signatures. This is the NIF layer, it's a special C layer that transforms and works with this library, transforms all parameters back to their line, back and forth. And also this C, this NIF is also written in C, and it's responsible to make some special calls to the OSCP server. This server is used to validate the digital signature, like a user who have a digital signature can blacklist the digital signature, can lost it. And this, and this OSCP server have all information like about all blacklisted signatures that are out of date or was blacklisted by any other reason. And this call sometimes can take significant time. This is important. So this digital signature microservice receive a special request. It's just a REST request which contains encoded JSON document. This document is encoded and signed by digital signature. It must process with this library. It must validates this digital signature, it must decode the document and then pass it to another microservices in the infrastructure of the e-health. So it must provide the answer in a time less than 5 seconds, because all your health infrastructure set up in that way that all microservices wait about 5 seconds for a response from another microservices. So we must provide this response in a timely manner. Okay, this is an example of the code. All this neat stuff transforms in only one function. We have a digital signature module, and we have only one function which process signed data, encoded in signed data, it sends encoded data itself, it accepts a set of certification database, and this parameter is not very significant, and it returns the result of the decoding and validation of signature. It returns the decoded content, in this case it was very simple JSON, it validates the digital signature and it returns the signer information. Like, it's pretty standard stuff that enclosed in the digital sign envelope. Okay, all this sounds pretty easy. We have a Phoenix application, we have a bunch of incoming requests. Each request comes to the Phoenix application, it transforms to Elixir process, it must call this digital signature leap, and this is the one about function, it must process document and return response. Everything sounds simple, but in the real life it's not so simple. It's not so simple because this library have problems with the concurrency. Like, we can test this very simple if we will try to launch, like, for example, 25 tasks asynchronously. All these tasks will try to process some kind of a simple document and return the response. We will see something like this. We will see like 5 or 4 correct responses, and then we will see some kind of stuck trace, because this library have some problems with freeing or allocating a memory in concurrent way. And as I said before, we can do anything without it, we can change it, so no way of making it like the easy way. So here comes the gen server. The gen server allows us to solve our problem in a way that if we use gen server methods to wrap the call to our digital signature library, then every request will be put as a message in the queue of the gen server, and they will all be processed sequentially, so no more concurrent problems. Everything is very easy. So we're introducing a gen server. Like, we have a client-facing method that just accepts the signed content, and it will make a call to the gen server. Gen server will receive the signed content, it will process the database with the certificates, and it just wraps the call to this library. But now these calls will be made in not concurrent but in sequential way. So it's pretty easy. We have a bunch of incoming requests. They will be transformed in the message queue inside the gen server and processed one by one, and responses will be provided back to the another services. So one problem solved. But we have another problem. This problem will with timeouts. Like, processing every of these messages will take some time, and because of this OCSP verification, it can take some significant time. So if we have like 4 requests incoming at once, and we need 2 seconds to process every request, then we will be able to provide correct answers like for first 2, but second we will time out in 5 seconds, the request processes will die, and user will get 500 error because no one left a response, which is pretty bad. Like, how can we solve it? Oh, and there is another problem. Like, this request will definitely die in 5 seconds, but it doesn't mean that the message queue of the gen server will be clean. Like, we have 2 500 errors, we have 2 new incoming requests, but gen server can be still processing one of these messages despite the fact that the process that will wait for this response is already dead. So it's another problem. If we have a peak in requests, then for the very long time until gen server will free message queue, everyone will have this 500 error because it will never be able to catch up in a timely manner. So this situation is not very good. Like, we can fight this in 2 ways. Like, First wave is from the point of the architecture of our system, because digital signature is just a microservice. We can start a bunch like 8, 10, 20 of these microservices. We can have a load balancer that will distribute the load between these microservices. So we don't have a situation when the server is overloaded, but still we can launch 1,000 of microservices, and we can have a peak in the incoming request. We can have a peak when we have like 1,000 incoming requests. So this will solve part of the problem, but not all. There will be times when the server will not be able to process all messages anyway. Not very often, but there will be this time. So another solution for this problem is just to catch exit signal. Like on the client side, we can not just try to call the server with some kind of predefined timeout, but we can drop this code in the try do block. And we will just catch this exit signal. So if the server call, we try to rise catch, it will not kill our process. We will just return back standard Elixir tuple, like error and the reason of the server. And finally, the reason of the server will be converted to the normal error message to the user, like 404, not 500. It's not the solution, but at least it is better from the user point of view, because it will have some error, like meaningful error, not just error showing him the process dies. Okay, but this doesn't solve our problem with message queue, because we have processed few messages, we are stick here, this message is timeouted and returned 44 error, but we still have incoming messages and our JIT server is still stuck here and it will never reach here in time of matter. So now all users will have not 500 but meaningful error, but still we will not be able to process their requests. There is another way to mitigate it. We can introduce an expiration time inside our message. Like we can create expiration time like its current time plus adding some JSON terminal value. Like we know that our JSON call can wait not more than 5 seconds, because our microservice as a whole must provide an answer in 5 seconds. So waiting time can be more than 5 seconds. Like we can wait for 4 seconds. So we can calculate the time when the message will be expired. Like if the processing message will take more than 4 seconds, we don't interested in the answer. So we are including the expiration time in our call to JIT server. And on JIT server side, when JIT server will pick up this message from the queue, we can validate if this message is still actual. So if the client is still waiting for this message, like if we can see that it's already like more than 5 seconds or 4 seconds, this message is more than 4 seconds old, that there is no use to try to process the payload of this message, because no one is waiting for the answer. So using this simple trick, we can just skip the messages that's already expired. So we can limit the workload of the JIT server and allow it to process only the messages that's within some threshold and will be able to receive this answer and process it. So the trick is pretty simple, but it allows us to lower payload on the JIT server in some time pretty significantly. Yes, some users still will receive the error answers, but in any way we will be able to process much more messages, or at least more messages in this way, because we will never spend this 2 seconds or 1 second or half a second processes messages that was sent by the request that already expired by this time when we go to this message. Another solution that we can use, maybe not in case of this digital service, but in if we have the same pattern, the same problem, is just introduce another JIT server that will work like a queue dispatcher. It will have an internal queue. We can use the message queue, or we can introduce the Erlang queue. Erlang have a queue module that can work with queues. The idea is that this QService, another job service, can provide us additional monitoring and control of our working service. Like if we can check that that our working service is stuck for some way, or it takes like too much time to answer, or like we have already 1,000 of messages that were discarded because they was processed in timely manner, we can just try to restart this server. Because if we have some complex C code here, this C code can stuck or something else can happen, this additional service will be the layer that will provide our monitoring and control functions. So if needed, we will be able to send some kind of a kill sign up from here and restart the service. But restarting the service, we will not lose our queue. Our queue will be saved, and we will be able to start processing the messages from the point where we stop. So it's kind of a more advanced solution. And now the most complex part of it is the memory management. As you know, Elixir is garbage-collected language, but there are some patterns that you need to be aware of related to the memory management. And it's the case of our digital signature service, because our payload, these envelopes with signed documents, is pretty large. It's not like 10 megabytes, but it's pretty large in the terms of the Erlang itself. And binary terms that are larger than 64 bytes, they are stored in a special heap. Like every process has its own private heap. When the process exchange with messages, these messages must be copied and stored in the private heap of the process, because the messages payload isn't shared. But in case of the large binaries, they are stored in one big shared heap. Because copying large binaries every time you need to exchange with messages between processes, it won't be very effective memory-wise. So they're stored in a large shared heap, and every process that works with this binary have its own smaller object. It's called probbin. Its object is just a pointer to this large shared heap. And the garbage collecting in this shared heap is a reference counting. So all the every this probbin object, it's one reference to the large binary in the heap. And when we are making a call of GAN server and passing this large binary, we are actually copying this probe bin. So GAN server with his own copy of this probe bin pointer, and the counter of the links for the binary in the shared heap will increase for a while. But the problem is that this probe bin pointer is very lightweight. And if we have this dispatcher process that will just pass this large binary to another worker and will only barely touch it, but it will have a copy of this probe bin. And even if this probe bin is not very actual, because it's very lightweight, it can take very, very significant time, because our gen server will be garbage collecting, because garbage collector in Elixir starts when it thinks that the process takes too much memory, but because of very lightweight nature of this probe bin, it can take very significant time. And until our GAN server will be garbage collected, all these probe bins will be alive, and even despite they are marked for collection. And all messages in the share heap, all these large binary messages in the share heap, will also be alive and will not be garbage collected. So this is kind of a problem, because we have a GAN server that works as a dispatcher. It processes a very large amount of these binaries. It will have pretty large amount of these probe bin pointers, but the shared heap will continue to rise until the garbage collector will start from this for this GAN server. It can take very, very long time, so it's a problem. It's a simple diagram that show how it works. We have incoming requests. Each of these requests will have its own probe bin pointer. We have all these messages related to these pointers in the shared heap, and when our messages will make calls to the gen server, this probe bin will be copied in gen server, and then our request will produce some kind of response, correct or not, it doesn't matter. And these processes will die, they will be garbage collected, so this probe bin pointers will be garbage collected, but this not until we won't start separate garbage collection for the NIF service. So until we start this garbage collection manually,
do not have a growing shared heap. So there is a different way when you can engage this garbage collecting manually. We are using pretty simple trick. In the init part of our game server, we are sending ourselves a message. This message will be sent after some preset time. This message contains a fresh header, and there is also a special handler in the game server. It handles all these kinds of special messages. It's called handle-info. So when this handle-info receives a special refresh message, it refreshes not only our game server, it not only starts garbage character in our game server, it also works to refresh a database of the certificates that used to validate digital signatures. But anyway, this message arrives like once in 30 minutes. And when this message arrives, we are collecting the garbage, so all the problem will die and shared heap will finally clear. And then we are just establishing another this message that will arrive our game server in the same detail in another 30 minutes. And that's all. There is a few another ways that can be used. If we will look at the handle call the gen server function documentation, it can accept additional parameters. This parameter can be not accept, but when it returns its answer, like in this part or in this part, it can accept additional parameters that will not be returned to the caller, but it will be used inside our gen server. This parameter can be some timeout or hibernate. If we're using hibernate, we are hibernating our gen server, it will hibernate until the next message arrives, but as a result of this hibernation, the garbage collector will be started. The idea is that you should use this hibernate function if you process very large messages, but these messages arrive rarely, because this hibernates allow you to save the resources, but it takes pretty large amount of time. So if you hibernate in every answer, your gen server becomes slower. So it's not a good idea to hibernate whatever answer on the gen server that takes a high load of messages. This parameter allows you to set some timeout. So if your gen server replies and this timeout will pass and no new messages will arrive to your gen server, it will also initiate this handle-info function call, and you can use this handle-info function to make some cleanup. So idea is that if your game server has a period of high load and then a period of idle time, you can use this idle time as timeout. And if you know that you will not receive any message, new messages soon, you can use this timeout and you can run the cleanup function that will process the garbage collection. So the pattern that you use, like this message that is started by timer or this message that is allowed you to collect garbage after every message of this that will allow you to make some cleanup in the middle time, it really depends on the flow of your logic. So if you have a high load, you can, and this high load is can be predicted. You can do this in like some timely manner, like in some standard in some standard time, like 30 minutes, 50 minutes, or as much as you need. If you receive large messages, but this case is rare, you can use this hibernate part, or if you have a peak load and then a large idle time, you can use this timeout feature. Also, there is some useful links that you can use. I can highly recommend this book, because this book is a very detailed description of all this OTP stuff. Like, it shows you how to build it yourself, like the similar logic yourself, and then it comes to standard functions that is already provided for you by the OTP framework. And this is a few good talk. This one is good talk, and this is a few good blog post on the similar problems. Like, you can read this. It describes pretty the same cases or look-alike cases and how people resolve. And these two things, it's two blog posts, this is very good describing all the details of the garbage collecting in Erlang and as a result in Alexa, despite the fact that the language is garbage collector, you should be aware of some patterns when you can really produce problems with the memory overloading. Okay, that's all. Thank you. Yes, but the problem is that even with two void, you can like have five concurrent threads, but it will kill the library anyway.
But still bad.
Still, you must stick with one process, or you must change this library, which is not very easy. We are looking into that, but
like you mean like one process is not concurrent, just like sequential?
Yes. Yes.
And you're using them to use.
Yeah, you can use whatever you want. The problem is that the whole your health system is built with Elixir.
I have a question. Do you have some limitations with third-party services? I mean, you can use for this kind of tasks, for example, RS Lambda.
The problem is that all infrastructure of the health is resized. For now, it's resizing the bare hardware mostly. So, like, we can deploy whenever we want. Like, we must deploy our system on the bare metal, and this is the government requirement.
But this is not a problem. You can still have your system on bare metal, but you can have one on the service with this kind of work.
I'm not sure that this is the case because we use only one provider. It was selected by special procedure, so unfortunately we can spread our services whenever on whatever system we want. Unfortunately, we must stick with providers that is chosen by government. So it's not the case.
Do you have any issues with NIFs, like supporting?
Sorry, I.
How successful was, how easy it was to start using NIFs, native automated functions?
No, it was hard. It was hard, but it works finally. So everything is good. But it's not easy task, and I better try to not use all this C and NIF stuff if you can.
And do you have it working on the same VM?
What do you mean by the same instance?
Like the same instance of LLVM as the main application. It's not like a separate service.
No, it's not a separate service. I think it works on the same beam like main application.
Who makes calls to these OCSP services? Elixir or the library?
No, nor library, not Elixir, but C code inside this new module.
There are like two libraries. One is just
kind of, but this NIF part is written by us, and this digital signature verification library is provided by another company.
So, would it make sense to split it as a kind of few functions? Because now you treat it like a sheet. This
yes, you can split it.
We have one function that like we don't take care of, but if that call specific to check if the signer is not trusted or whatever, it takes 2 seconds. Why it makes sense to map it, like put it together with it?
Kind of the problem that without this call, anyway, we can't return the result to the caller. So with this call made inside the NIF module or a separate function, we must still stick with this 5 second delay. Yes, from
the. At the same time, you can map it, just send a request, and while we are waiting for the response, you can just process another request.
No, it's not the case because the part of forming this request is depends on this library. So anyway, we need to like make this all sequential. We can pass some part of the code to this library and manage request and then part another code.
But this
at
is
it will be pretty complex to do.
This is basically what the asynchronous programming is.
Yes, yes, I understand. But problem is not separating this part and other part. The main problem is that we can't start multiple instances of this library. If this problem can be solved, that everything else will be much, much easier.
To tell you the truth, most of the libraries that does the crypto stuff concurrent. So you would have it with any library. Even OpenSSL has the same problem. It's not concurrent library. You take some other like alternatives to OpenSSL. It's also you have to protect the because they operate in the same.
Yes, I see a point. Maybe we can save some time by trying to separate it, but it's not a very easy case.
Yeah, the thing is that you are working on the crypto stuff. It's basically happening inside your
computer, and
you're sending a request to check the signer, which is like separate job, and this can be...
Yes, I see. It's a good point, but it's not very easy to give you an answer right now because you will prove something, because really, we need to make a few calls to this library to prepare the special object that can be sent to Zell. Oh, or to his server. Some, I think it's possible, but it's not very easy. But yes, it's a good point.
One more question. Why did you choose the NIC instead of port?
It's pretty complex stuff. When I was start working with the service, like already half of the NIC was made, and from the beginning we don't have any idea that we will have such problem with running concurrent jobs with this library. So the NIC was looking like a good starting point, and maybe we can get something by transferring to the port. But I'm still not sure that even like if we start this library in separate application, the port system will. You don't have any problems with concurrent.
But in this case, you can start few ports and have a queue, for example, of 5 jobs.
Yeah, but we can easily start 5 additional microservices. So it's not such a big deal. We have problems when like a peak load, like 1,000 of messages, which would be hard to mutate from the point of microservices or from the point of ports, like. Sometimes load is pretty evenly distributed and everything is okay, but sometimes we have like very unusual, very high peak load. So the problem is that in such cases we must do anything to like protect our servers from freezing and return like some normal errors to the users, like timeout errors, like this 44 instead of 500.
How does this Elixir processes relate to the operating system processes? Is the same thing or?
Oh no, Elixir processes is not the same thing. They're managed by the bin, by the run.
So they live in the same process. In the OS on the process and Elixir lives in that process. Or it has multiple?
No, it can have multiple. Usually this bin machine have multiple dispatches. Every of the dispatcher is kind of tied to the operating system process, to the real process. And then they're distributing internal processes between these operating system processes and manage them. So from the programming point of view, like all these processes managed inside the virtual machine, but from the real point of view, they can be distributed between operating system processes. But it's pretty hard to predict which one will get to. Which real operating system process.
This third-party library that you start, it's kind of spawns in one process, or you can start it in multiple processes?
You can try to start it in multiple processes, but right now, with this all the server stuff, of course, it's started in one operating system process. Anyone? Okay, then thank you. That's all.
Thank you. I didn't understand much, but anyway.
I hope it's not because my English.
No, it's because my Elixir is terrible. Don't worry. Okay, so at the moment we are having a 5-minute coffee break, and then we'll continue our way some journey into the Elixir world. Thank you.